Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Museum of Chinese and America. My name is Dennis Yuyet Lee. I'm the Director of Performance, Storytelling, and Community. Together with my co-worker, Director of Programs, Yifang Wu, we really welcome you to this beautiful event at MOCA. It really is our honor to have Russell with us today to share with you his collection of poems and paintings, MothSutra. As you can see, it's a very beautiful painting. It's particularly special for us to present this program now, given June is also the Immigrant Heritage Month, if you haven't known already, it is in addition to being the Pride Month. Let me briefly introduce our speakers, Russell and also Neely, today. Russell is the founding editor of the CUNY Forum and served as the Dr. Thomas Tam Visiting Professor at Hunter College, CUNY. He's also the former editor of Emerasia Journal from 1977 to 2010 at UCLA, where he also taught English and Asian American studies. Leong, educated in Taiwan and the U.S., is the author of Phoenix Eyes. We have a copy right there, a short story, Phoenix Eyes and Other Stories, which received the American Book Award. Leong also received his MFA in Film and Theater from UCLA. You can visit his works, more recent works, on his website. That is russellleongwrites.com. I can share that with you later, or you can just visit our website. We have that on our website. Our other reader, Mi-Ling Xu, was born in Hong Kong and immigrated to New York at 14, trained in English, literature, and journalism. She worked as a documentary producer and a human rights advocate focused on mainland China. She is currently translating into English a memoir by a Chinese dissident who was imprisoned for 7 years for supporting the 1989 democracy movement. I want to talk a little bit about how I make a connection to Russell. So I first came across Russell's work during my research on queer Asian American histories. The book, Asian American Sexualities, Dimensions of the Gays and Lesbian Experiences, edited by Russell and published in 1996, is undoubtedly biblical. And I just talked with Russell earlier, and I believe this is the very first book that focuses on queer Asian American identity. A collection of articles, essays, transcriptions, and creative writings by queer Asian American activists, scholars, and artists illuminates the fact that as a gay man in diaspora, like myself, I am not alone and I am no other. In the introduction, Russell wrote, quote, home bodies, homelands, homosexuals. This litany begins at home. Through words and ideas, we seek ourselves as we seek others. Asian American, Pacific Islander American, but not homogenous, homegirls, and homeboys, end quote. So homo is never homogenous, but in fact, multifaceted and diverse. And this story, this history we have written and continue to write, starting from home here in New York City, here in Chinatown, is in no way homogenous either. But we're not here to really explore and discuss sexualities today. I wanted to share this quote with you to allude to the fact that we do seek or see ourselves when we seek or see others. And this is the main theme of today's program, the life of a delivery man, whom traditionally and unfortunately is usually unnamed, unseen, in a society that appreciates the working class very little. But this is one of the stories closest and dearest to our hearts. The railroad workers, the laundryman, the garment factory workers, the restaurant workers, and now the delivery man. The stories of our forefathers and foremothers, our friends and family, our neighbors, or even ourselves. And that's why we're here today with Russell's work. Today, Russell actually brings some copies of the MothSutra. We will sell today. And if you are interested after the program, you can check it out. All the proceeds will be donated to Fuzhou America, a grassroots organization that advocates for the Fuzhouese community rights and also promotes and preserves Fuzhouese cultures. So before I pass the microphone to Russell and begin our reading, I would like to also share with you a video of the late Chinese American labor historian, Peter Kwong, who actually passed away in 2017. When they first did this reading in 2015, Peter was there, and he made a very beautiful introduction to this reading. So without further ado, let's take a look at the introduction.
Okay, yeah, this is kind of an homage to Peter, because Peter was one of the first people who actually talked about New York in terms of uptown and downtown. And we're downtown now, right? Or anyway, we're not uptown. So, you know, Peter is very prescient and very eloquent, and also a dear friend for a long time, and from college days and so forth. And here's to Peter once again.
MothSutra is a multi-visual piece of art worthy of a master. Historically, New York's Chinatown has always attracted disproportionate number of working class Chinese as compared to other cities in the United States. The reason being, New York has a very large low-wage labor market. The lowest and most difficult ones for the women, I would say it must be garment seamstress. But for men, there's no question. Deliver men should be considered as the bottom of the totem pole. They're hardly paid, mostly from tips. The jobs are dangerous, as you probably know, rob regularly, and even kill. And they also consider as outsider, even working in the restaurants. They hardly have any connections with the waiters, with the chefs, or with the kitchen, other members of the kitchen staff. As a group, they have been looked down upon as newcomers. Russell's depiction of them as moth is really right on point. Over the years, though, marginalized as these people were, they have been organizing and went on strike to assert their rights. There are lots of different venues of community arts in Chinatown, but few dealing with the lives of working people. In the 1970s, there were a number of murals done by Asian American students and artists. Russell's current work is a new addition. However, it touches us deeper. His is different because he lived there. He lived in the community. And those delivered men are his friends.
Before Mi Ling and I start, I just wanted to say this work was done almost 10 years ago, and certain things have changed. Of course, the delivery men now, they use these apps, Hungry Panda, Fantuan, and so forth, and they have electric motors. In 2015, the electric motors were mainly illegal, and there's a little bicycle shop on Broome Street that a lot of delivery guys used to go to retrofit their bikes, but it was illegal. But even though they have electric motors and the fancy apps, but they are still migrant workers, because nobody will take responsibility for their welfare. The restaurants say, well, actually, you're working for the app. The app said, well, you're independent workers. So it's a real dilemma. So even though the work was written some years ago, hopefully it tries to convey the inner life of the SOMI, the delivery workers, and also the society around them. I did live in Chinatown on Christie Street, right across from the park. And that's how, this project developed. Not all my friends were delivery guys. Some were Tai Chi kind of masters. Some were sort of home health aid workers. Some were cooks. Some were scammers trying to sell these long life potions for $100 and so forth. So the whole park, Sarah Delano Roosevelt Park, there's a lot of people used to hang out there. And so basically when I was out there doing Tai Chi, I'd run into all kinds of people, and it's not just doing Tai Chi. I mean, a lot of restaurant workers and people who work in community went out there to do to exercise before they went to work. And it's not just Tai Chi, but it's like communication. You know, people would kind of gossip and convey all kinds of information. And so that's basically, if you hang around in the park long enough, you basically can, you know, certain things will inspire you. So this poem, MothSutra, is actually dedicated to all the people in the community. When it was first published, we worked with the Bicycle Coalition to try to improve safety on bikes. Because, you know, those bike delivery guys were a little bit dangerous, you know. I mean, you'd be standing there and they'd be like swooping and almost knock you off the street, right? So anyway, as I said, things have changed, but yet certain things remain the same. And we're really happy to have Mi-Ling help us. I decided I was going to read some Chinese, but my Chinese is kind of shitty. So I said, okay, I need help. So I called upon my old friend Sharon, and Mi-Ling came to the rescue. Thank you, Mi-Ling. And Mi-Ling, of course, knows both Cantonese and Putonghua. So some of the sections will be read in Cantonese, and some will be read in Putonghua, actually. And the loop behind you is done by Ari, and these are kind of images from the book. And so if, you know, I'm incomprehensible, just enjoy the pictures, and, you know, that's what it's for. Because basically, you know, when people hear poetry, it's kind of not understandable. So it's better to do pictures, right? I don't know. But Mi-Ling has a much better voice than I do, and I'm sure the Chinese will be very elegant and eloquent. So thank you all for coming. Thank you to Mocha. It was a difficult decision because I got a lot of heat. There's a lot of picketing, you know, every weekend. And I know artists and, you know, community people on both sides of the picket line. Fortunately, when I came this afternoon, the picketing was gone. So I didn't really have to cross the picket line this afternoon. But anyway, I would like to say that when I was growing up in San Francisco Chinatown in the 1950s, there were very few cultural institutions. You know, I don't think we had a Chinese American Museum or Historical Society, very, very few. So these are very precious spaces for our community. And I think that I'm glad, you know, Mocha's here. And basically, hopefully, it's open to many, many communities, whether Asian or queer communities, old seniors, whatever, and hopefully you can start serving jok and stuff in the morning, and, you know, like zhou, you know, rice gruel, so we can have more reason to come. You know, New York has such a great system of senior centers, you know. They're always serving, right, breakfasts and stuff. Anyway, getting to the poem, we're going to start now. So anyway, we're going to start. Anyway, it actually starts with the poem. I'll just read. I will read English, and then Mi-Ling will read some of the excerpts in Chinese. Crossings. 十字路口. That's the name in Chinese. Rising in the east, falling to the west, a man throws his body to the light. He enters the city of luster and ash. He balances his body on a bike, dodges the gridlock of samsara, enfolds the world through his vertical third eye. From Hudson to Harlem, across the river east, can he escape the fate of odd numbers stamped evenly on his neon orange vest? 008 20041577 808-989-005. Numbers configure him, transport him, deport him. Destinations upstream, intersections downstream, face 10,000 crossings, efface 10,000 cravings. Cycle, like motorcycle, bicycle. Throw your body to the light. Walk 88, Uncle Hunan, Bangkok Orchid, Karma Sushi, Debbie Delight, Tiger Tail Takeout, link your body to this cycle, lock and steel chain, slung across your chest, claim continents, cross islands, balance styrofoam cartons of five spice shrimp, curry lamb, cashew chicken, basmati rice in bags that weigh down both your handlebars, catch just enough tailwind to move you through Manahata, Lexington 5th, Madison 3rd, 6th, 9th, East Side to West Side, Sutton Place, Soho House Kitchen, Canal, wherever the hell takeout delivers you tonight. Cycle. Towers. Remember 9/11, guys? Waylaid at the door of cravings, only to meet a mirage of quartz, towers that rise from the Atlantic floor, knock on the diamond sutra door, find a fathom, phantom, and a flash of lightning which struck one pure September day. How some could not jump quickly enough from the twin towers. Accountants and waiters, upturned sleeves, fluttering like moth, delicate wrists, too close to the fires. Towers,
高楼大厦, 玉门关外, 通明精亮的神景, 让你如, 预习般地, 惊讶不已, 扣开金刚门, sorry, 扣开金刚经的大门, 9月11号, 那个明净的秋日, 惊艳的, 晴天沐影和电闪雷鸣那些来不及从双子塔跳下去的冤魂会计们和服务生卷起的袖口像飞蛾一般扑腾柔弱的手腕淹没在火海里
Camouflage. Now, he startles old women, trips up tourists in their prime. They curse the zigzag wheels that head down upon them with such a brown man at the wings, darkness being his camouflage, his cocoon. At dusk, he could pass for, say, a Lenape, or a Lee, or a Latino. He could be wearing stone and teeth, a silver cross, or 108 lotus seeds wound around his neck. Now, could this guy be Zhuangzi, climbing the stairwell, fixated at a corner, leaning against the lamppost? For the record, he ain't Zhuangzi, who dreamed that he'd be a butterfly, or that the butterfly might be dreaming. It was a man. He's not a dreamer or a butterfly, neither moth nor man.
Camouflage in Cantonese. 偽裝, 如今, 他嚇壞老太太, 半島年輕光鮮的遊客, 他們就早, 人群裡穿梭的車輪上, 撐着翅膀, 黑不溜秋的他, 黑夜是他的偽裝, 他的巢, 入夜後, 他可以是個印第安人, 某個姓李的, 或者拉丁裔, 他可能戴着石頭, 和牙齒串的項鏈, 銀製的十字架, 或者108顆鏈子, 他會是莊子嗎? 爬上石街, 倚着街角的电线杆, 可惜他终究不是庄子，梦见自己是蝴蝶，或者蝴蝶梦见自己是个人。他不是做梦的人，或者蝴蝶，也不是飞蛾，或者人。
You know, in Sarah Delano Roosevelt Park, a lot of guys used to bring their bamboo bird cages out there on the weekend and show each other and talk about how they smuggled this one in or how much this one cost. Anyway, the next section is called Cages, and it's about that phenomenon. Cages. Throw your body to the light. Who dares to wake you up now from your single Broom Street bed? Your brother, your sister, your lover? Do you still glide through a twilight dream? Not at Mercury with your naked eye? Has the earth slipped away again? Have these walls, this floor, this basement room turned into a bamboo cage? Can you hear the bright-eyed Huame birds across Christie Park where a dozen cages hang? Stop the wind. Lift the tarps off the cages. Only then the captured birds uncovered begin to sing their wilderness songs. You hear distant sounds, those who stowed away before you. Adventure, like adventure. Caught in a net of bamboo, caged in back of a truck, crossing from Yunnan to Laos to Thailand, a Liberian ship to Kenya, the Cape of Good Hope, then Rockaway Bay, Queens, not knowing the hour of dawn, they jump from the Golden Venture, tumbling into the summer sea. But who can deny that his heart is still plummeting, his feet still wet, exiting the number 7 train, walking through the rain in Flushing.
Venture in 普通话. 困身在卡车后面，从云南到老挝，到泰国，一艘比利亚开往肯亚的船，经好望角到皇后区的洛克威海湾，不知黎明何时来到，他们纵身跳下金石历险号，挣扎着沉入海里。 就在那个炎热的夏天，可是谁能说他的心不是还在下沉？他的脚还是湿的，离开了七号火车，走在雨中的法拉盛。
So elegant, you're a butterfly.
Huh?
You're a butterfly.
I am?
Yeah. All these guys just stay... All these guys just stay moth. But there's a few butterflies, you know. right? Names. Names. Now, what's in a name? What's in your name? Is your name real or fake? Call me by my name or not? Donald Dunn, Prince Lee, Yahoo Yang. Lucky tags I've cooked up for myself. I deliver your order with extra hot sauce, no splinter chopsticks, fork over a meal ticket on your future next month's all you can ever eat forever coupon. Sir, miss, your food is here. No cash only. To the vegan who orders his stir fry without the beef, what's that all about? Credit, we charge extra. $1 more per order? Yes, that's the rules. Now, there's always the one who wants the shrimp without batter. No change. Sorry. Could tip me more. More if you want. You can. Now, another on the Upper East Side will pay like $5 for fake kosher dumplings with tofu. What's that all about? Okay. How can that be? Pay more for less? Big Americans. Simple hearts. They want too little. I want too much. hover like a moth, like a butterfly, without Western words. You're a stranger here, almost mute, hover outside the restaurant doors, leave your taillights blinking in the dusk. You line up the lotto numbers with the new brown man beside you. He could be 40 or 50 or even 60, because their faces are hidden by identical helmets. You lean like butterflies into the window's light. Off shift, you bus it to Heavenly World Casino, letting the video game chatter dim the drone of jets departing for Paris, Dubai, Beijing, over JFK, soaring above everything. Your old name is now gone. Not that you want it back, the one you left when you came here. That's gone. Flew away like a moth. Whoever called you that. Tailgaters. Indentured faces from familiar places. Shantou, Sanya, Fuzhou, outcast. How a lover lost can never return, but tailgaters from China, Somalia, Honduras overshadow you on these refugee streets, claim yet another place beneath the sun. Your accent marks you anyway. You can never freely cast away all those whom you owe, from Foshan to Flushing. They will phone you or text you, forage for a limb or for dollars, embody your flesh or your family, plumb across the Pacific. In your village town, that old village town along the river, they say a moth is an old friend, someone whom you knew or once loved, who has departed but now returns. Maybe the moth taps upon the window, grazes your shoulder, spots a shadow on your dirty table. Tongues, like this tongue here, or language. Rim by scrappy rim, spoke by twisted spoke, a bike crosses 85th at Central Park. Blood leaf, fallen snow, wayward cloud, broken blossom, steel and cement, joy and lament, all seasons of samsara. On the park bench, an African woman shades herself under a parasol of posies, speaks in holy tongues to stop the devil, heal the hopeless, save blistered souls. She does not mind the dubious Asian monk in wrinkled saffron robe and baseball cap who, instead of the Eightfold Path, pitches towards a fast ticket to Nirvana. Someone must pay for someone to win. The butterfly effect, he shrugs. Vagrant. Throw your body to the light, neon, fluorescent, LED. It's way past 12 already. Work your wheels downtown, bring yourself back home to Bowery. Midnight, the street has closed its mouth. No one's praying at the Holy Ukrainian Church. No one's washing clothes at the Levi laundromat. All those who need a back rub at Water Lily Spa must stand back until tomorrow. No more moon. Night reroutes your body through its vagrant mind. So you're biking. Blue spokes release the red flames. Handlebars relax your fingers. Pedals free your feet from the cycling of your earthbound body. Midnight to dawn, you deliver only the dreams of an exile. Swap your northern bike for southern wheels that carry you back to Sanya, that town above the equator where you were cast out. Island of itinerant monks and migrant workers like you, who perch like a moth on top of the steel elevator and really envy the sea, a blue jewel that will never be yours, sparkling. Nor will you awaken blissfully in those marble towers you built for others at the edge of sky and ocean. Sanya.
Exile in Putonghua. Fang Zu. Lan Shi Hu Tiao. Hua Chu Hong Shi Huo Yan. So Bin Fang Sung Ni Jiang Ying the Sou Zi. Fang Zai Di Sha. Wu Ting Shen Zuan the Ni the Sun Ti. Ta Ban Shi Fang Ni the Jiao. Wu Ye Dao Li Ming. Ige Liu Wang Zhi. Qi Zao. 贪黑的梦, 北方单车换来南方的轮回, 你回到曾经容不下你的三亚, 那个赤道边上的小城, 岛上游方僧人和外来工人, 和你一样, 向着飞蛾伫立在钢筋吊架上, 善慕大海, 一颗永远不属于你的蓝宝石, 你做梦也不曾设想, 这些你用大理石, 为他人在天涯海角, 堆砌的高楼大厦。
Island. This island. With dawn, trucks moving again, driven upon your ears, Chinese and Spanish drivers curse their overseers, praise their wooden Madonnas and brass Buddhas. On this island plantation, forklifts dump wooden pallets, boxes of double green long beans, Del Monte bananas, Kingsburg glacial peaches, Chilan Washington cherries, Costa Rica pineapple, China bitter melon, star papaya on the pavement, a rat's leap above your room where the new world is a wonder wheel. Latitudes of interlocked passengers in glock cages, steerage spinning above the waters of Atlantis, across interstates and states of being, Canal Street to Canal Point, takeout joints from New York to Florida. You've delivered yourself to all latitudes, north and south. Yet, for you, the earth remains insular. A narrow, narrow island of fortune and misfortune. From dawn to dusk, a man, like old women like you and me, unfolds his mind. Between lines of littered streets and imaginary sutras, he moves toward a dustless horizon. He throws his body to the light. Let me also give a shout out to Roman Shea, a friend and colleague of mine who actually translated the poem, who's actually a poet himself. He's from Hunan province. He's actually lives in China now. But, you know, he's a very fine poet, and probably you could tell from Miling's reading, probably the Chinese is more beautiful than the English. I'm sure.
Thank you so much, Russell. We want to open the floor up if you have any questions you would like to ask Russell for this collection of poetry.
Thank you. Well, thank you for being here, for accepting us, for allowing us to have voices, and we want to hear more of them.
Yeah, hopefully.
We have been silenced for too long.
Yeah, hopefully this encourages all the people in the room to write more. And actually, we're publishing your poem, right? Soon, about your mom.
Thank you for publishing it.
Yeah, we're going to be publishing. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
It's a poem I submitted to AAARI called Wounding Shan Becomes a Lian Chow. It's about my mother and her immigration, her identity from being Chinese to becoming an American Chinese, and the hopes and what she gained and what she lost.
Yeah, well,
also honoring her. When I read her that poem, I mentioned her parents' names. I don't think she had her parents' names in 50 years. And it was my way of giving back to my family that they're honored, that their names existed. She existed. She survived. And so I'm very, very grateful for you and all of that to be published.
No, grateful to you because part of being a writer is to encourage other writers. We don't want to listen to ourselves all the time, right? That would really be a drag. We would rather listen to you. So even if you think you're not a writer, well, you can actually just write something simple, like in a blog, whatever, on a napkin. You would really be surprised. And somehow it will stand the test of time.
Can you share a little bit of how you first got into writing poetry for you, or was it some other kind of
thing? I really couldn't think in long. I'm not a lawyer like you. I can't think in terms. I can't think in terms of this.
Lawyers lost a lot of creativity.
Well, I don't know. They have this new thing in law called critical race studies, and people actually do use poetry and literature, right? People like Mari Matsuda. But I'm not an analytical guy. I like to eat and play more than I like to think. So I thought poetry is a lot better for me, you know. So that's why I'm not a lawyer. I can't defend myself. I think and I'm kind of introverted guy. So I think for me, the responsibility of a poet is to, I guess in Chinese would be called 内心世界. It's kind of like the inner life, the inner world. Because, you know, we hear with social media and everything, we just hear too much. It's very hard to comprehend, too hard to digest. So I thought poetry is one way of trying to get underneath the skin and trying to get at other things. And even AI probably won't be able to, hopefully, I don't know whether AI can be poetic or not. I've used it a little bit. It's pretty flat, but it's improving, you know. So while we still have the chance, before AI takes over the world, we should all start writing poetry, right? But you asked how I got into poetry? Oh, okay. Basically, when I was little, we lived in a four-story Chinatown apartment. We really didn't have too much money, and my cousins, they would, when they finished reading with their encyclopedias and books, they would like give them to us to read. And first, I started making building blocks like trains and gas stations and railroads with the books, and then I started opening them, and you know, little phrases pop out here and there. And that's how you begin to, you know, when you start writing, you don't really know the difference between is it poetry or not? You just put something down, right? But I basically started out drawing first. So I actually prefer, now in my old age, I'm kind of lazy, so I would prefer doing images instead, because it's really interesting. A funny story, I gave a lot of these books and out to the people actually that I wrote about. Like, for instance, this particular image, I was in a store in Chinatown, and this Chinese lady, obviously she's from China, she came and I showed her this picture. I said, so what's happening here? And when I drew this picture, this guy is thinking of his laojia. There's a little house here. He was thinking of his home. But this modern Chinese lady from China, she says, oh, he's thinking about saving money to to buy some real estate here. So, all right, that was her interpretation of this picture. So it's really interesting that an image could be interpreted in many ways. So for her, she really couldn't read the English part, but then she looked at it, oh, this guy's thinking about buying real estate. So, okay, I thought that was valid. Maybe that was not my intention, but it's her interpretation. So once you write something or you draw something, it's not yours anymore. It's you just throw it out to the world. It's like the fly that sticks to the wall. And so that's how I kind of feel about it. Even though poetry or or the creative process is a personal thing, but it's also part of a, it's also a social process you share with people. So that's how I kind of look at poetry or art and so forth. One person I did know, he actually was a delivery driver. He was a student at one of the universities here, but he's from China, but he was also a food delivery guy. And he had come to the first reading, and we sort of became friends, and then we went to the park. He said he wanted to practice his English, so we were reading this book in the park in English until the sun kind of set. And he said he could identify as with the moth, because sometimes he felt kind of like a moth, a little bit invisible. Actually, he didn't have a way to spread his wings. So I was really moved, actually, when he told me that. Because most moths do not turn into butterflies, right? Or very, very few. Well, there's different kind of creatures. So the other thing is, in the book, you know, I said moth is the word for moth is called what? But as you notice, the left part is a worm, right? And the right part is kind of I. When you put it together, it becomes a moth. So when I did the book, at the beginning, there's a moth all over the place. But by the end, the picture just has the wall. So that means finding your identity or finding your expression. Like, I think for this one here, this must be toward the end. It's actually just shows the wall, not the moth. So, you know, I thought it was really interesting. And the sutra, Jing, usually people think of Jing as something Buddhist, but actually the original meaning in Pali, the original meaning in Pali is actually itiao xian, like a string or a cord. So it's a kind of a cord that connects people, connects ideas, and so forth. So it's kind of like a double meaning. So as I said, you know, I became a sort of a poet because I like to play and eat more than think. And with poetry, there's a lot of wordplay, especially in Chinese, but also in English, a lot of puns and double meaning. So it's fun, you know. Answer your question? Okay. Yeah.
Raymond. I have more personal questions. First of all, that was a great reading. But do you prefer drawing, or do you prefer writing poetry more for yourself?
Well, I first did the poem in English, and then I read it, and I said, this is kind of boring. I don't want to listen to it. So I went around with my phone and stuff and took a lot of pictures, and then I started making the drawings. So basically, I got bored by the text, and most people respond to the images more than the text, because who wants to listen to poetry, right? But you can actually see something and maybe think it's more fun. So, yeah, it's a visual culture, yeah. Oh yeah, of course, because you know, you have to there's a unemployment agency. What street is it? Is it on Foresight or on Foresight? You know, they used to have a lot of these unemployment agencies, and then also have a lot of these places where buses pick up workers to go to various places on the East Coast to work in restaurants and stuff. And so, you know, I would kind of walk past there and do a little bit of, you know, ethnographic research. You have to know what you're kind of talking about, right? And then in order to do this. And as I said, every morning I went to the park and learned Tai Chi from this older sifu, you know. And the way I got into it, at least in the park, one time I was doing my Tai Chi and this old guy comes and sits right in front of me on the bench like reading a newspaper. And he's kind of looking at me. Then after I finished the set, the taolu, then he talks to me in Cantonese. He says, you know, buddy, you're not doing the moves that correctly. Some of the moves are off. I said, yeah, I know. That's why I'm practicing. And then then he says, you know, the chun style, 那个城市, is my specialty, and I can actually help you to improve your moves. if you come here at 7:30 every morning. So 7:30 every morning, I was out in the park on Grand Street, you know, like Grant and Christy, practicing with him. And every morning, he would yell at me in Chinese, like, you have a slow brain. You know, you even learn slower than my white students. That was, no, you know, that was the ultimate insult. And it just kind of spurred me on, right? Spurred me on. And he would, like, curse at me, like, for 2 years. But then I realized, you know, because the park is a certain society, I realized it wasn't a personal thing. It's that everybody in the park who's learning Tai Chi, Kung Fu, or the sword, they have a teacher. And if I'm his student, they know I'm his student. So he doesn't want to look bad, you know, because everyone knows who's learning from whom. And but after 2 years, it was okay. He said, oh, you can teach the short form. Suddenly, he said that to me, and I thought, okay, it was worth it. He's shouting at me every morning, you know. And he has a very interesting history. His name is Mr. Wang Sifu. He used to paint all the signs in Chinatown before the neon and stuff. So he had a collection of all the signs that he painted. So his English is very good too, because he said when he painted the signs in Chinatown, they were in English and Chinese. So he had to make sure the English was correct. So, you know, it was a very interesting skill that he had. And he also taught the Chen style Tai Chi Quan. And, you know, I'm kind of into Tai Chi, and so is Bob and Eleanor, right? Eleanor, you teach Tai Chi, right? And Bob was, we have a great picture of Bob doing Tai Chi at Columbus Park, right? And actually, if you buy a copy of CUNY Forum, you can see his picture, right? Yeah, he's like, yeah, it's, and, the Kung Fu guy, I'm going to review his identity now because, you know, I threatened to have him do some Kung Fu, but I won't. He's Raymond over here. He's a, you're a Kung Fu champ, right?
I don't know about champ, but I've been doing it for a long time. It's something I enjoy a lot.
Yeah, yeah. And the interesting thing, the connection between Kung Fu, Tai Chi, and these workers is that, as I said, all the people in the park that were doing Chinese exercise, they were, they work in restaurants, or home health workers and stuff, and then they had to go to work pretty early in the morning. But at 7:30, they're still pretty early, 6, 7:30. So when they did their martial arts, I think a certain aspect of them came out that you won't find in the restaurant. Their identity, their being capable people, being able to do these kind of martial arts. And so, you know, it... You could see they were quite different people, and it gave them a certain kind of identity as men, and mainly they were men in the park, you know, doing the Tai Chi Quan and different types of wushu.
But thank you so much, Russell, for sharing this again. Thank you so much. So, yeah, the posters will be right there. I believe it's $20 per copy, and all the revenues will just donate to Fuzhou America. We have Angela Lee here with us representing Fuzhou America. Thank you so much. And please feel free to come back to Mocha. We have a lot more different programs. We also support writers, performing artists. We also support a lot of community organizations. If you ever need a space to meet up, to do all kinds of things, we're always here. Because that's our biggest mission. We want to be here for the community, and we want to help people preserve and presenting our own histories. So thank you. Have a good afternoon.